as a metaphysical one. Carpedian or hedonism is the desperate bid to outwit the onslaught of time by engagement in material delight. The whole of To His Coy Mistress is suffused with this spirit. The poem has three stanza, each having a definite purpose. The poem is written in a syllogistic pattern. The first stanza serves the purpose of introduction, the second as argumentation, and the third as conclusion. While the process of argumentation, one of the chief characteristics of metaphysical poetry is very clear and pointed. The poem is deeply concentrative, marked by deep concentration of thought. The first stanza opens dramatically with an argument. The poet tells his lady love, the coy mistress, in clear terms and very pointedly, that if they could love through eternity, he would, as her beauty deserved, spend thousands of years just for the appreciation of her physical beauty. He would spend 100 years on her eyes and forehead, 200 years on each breast, 30,000 on the rest of the organs of her body. The last days he would spend exploring the beauty that lay in her heart. Obviously, while marble lays stress more on physical charm and the attraction of the flesh, he gives less importance to the heart. As a matter of fact, Epicurean philosophy or hedonistic philosophy is predominantly conspicuous in the poet's emphasis on the enjoyment of sensuous pleasures. While the first stanza poignantly points out the brevity of life and the need of making the most of time in hand, the second stanza expresses the poet's awareness of the approaching death. Time's winged chariot hurrying near, he pleads with his coy mistress that before them lie the vast deserts of eternity. And the day is not far when her long preserved virginity would be consumed by the worms in her grave. Not only would her virginity be a meal for the worms, but also his own lust that is raising like fire in his body would die down and turn into ashes. If they waste their time and pass on into the grave without enjoying the sensuous pleasures, they would miss the chance forever, because in the private chambers of the graves, they would not have an opportunity to embrace each other. So the poet exhorts his lady love to hurry up, as it's time to please, to use the language of T.S. Eliot. The third stanza concludes the argument, and the poet opens the stanza with the words, "Now therefore," the words that are used when an argument is concluded. He pleads with his fiancée that in view of the brevity of life and youth, they should have immediate communion. They should not lose a moment. And as long as the youthful hue sits on her skin that reflects the flaming passion of her soul through every pore, they should begin the love sport. They should consume the present hours like amorous birds of prey rather than languish in the slow chamber. They should unite to form a single ball, totally effacing their separate identities and set it rolling and tear asunder the obstacles in their way. The iron gates of life, they cannot make the sun stand still, but they may send it on the run, giving it no scope to interfere with their sport of love. The poem, which is syllogistic in pattern with two premises and a conclusion, also betrayed several other features of metaphysical poetry. The first is concentration. The poem is from start to finish is concentrative, and the focal point is the poet's insistence on his beloved not to waste time but gather the rosebuds while they may. This point is argued out in three stanzas, and we are never allowed to waver or pause. The reference to the biblical deluge or to the Indian Ganges do not detract our attention even for a moment. We cannot help reading the poem in a single breath. The second characteristic of metaphysical poetry is raciocination or argumentation, embellished with nice speculation of philosophy. As we see the poem argues that since life is short, The lover should enjoy pleasures of sex without wasting a minute. The reference to the Bible or to collecting rubies by the side of the Indian Ganges or the hyperbolic utterances only bear the poet's argument that life is short and therefore it must not be wasted. The third characteristic is the use of conceits. Conceits are startling metaphors, being comparisons between things more unlike than like. The poet's proposal that they should unite so as to form a ball is a bold conceit. Like a ball that is restless, they once united would go on making love ceaselessly. The iron gates of life, which signify the obstacles that stand in their way, is also brilliant for its novelty. Time's winged chariot is a common metaphor, but its use is matchless. Our brain is jolted when the poet suggests that like amorous birds of prey who do not care about what is happening around when they make love, they should divert time instead of languishing in a slow chip form. The time diverse is a frightful phenomenon that man is always apprehensive of. But the poet's proposition to divert time by not wasting a single moment outside love play is definitely surprising. These lines, says Emile Boyce, are the very essence of the poetry of Marvel, the strange, sensuous, passionate Puritan. The poem contains beautiful romantic touches. This is evident when the poet compares the beauty of the coy girl to the morning dew, suggesting its evanescence, or when he asserts that the flame of passion in her soul transpires through the pores of her skin, making it a bloom. The poet's awareness of the brevity of life and of the approaching death is Shakespearean in its intensity of feeling. The hyperboles appear a little ludicrous, but that is momentarily, for as we move on, we get the message of the poem. The poet is explicitly sensual, and the sensuality becomes clear when he says that he would, if he had plenty of time, spend 200 years enjoying the beauty of each breast. But the sensuality is an adornment of the poem, for nowhere does the poet speak of platonic love. His whole thrust is upon the enjoyment of physical love, without allowing worms to feast on the girl's long preserved virginity, or without allowing his own fiery passion to die down. The whole poem is based on the theory of seizing the day, and poet is never coy in expressing what he wants to mean or have. Now, use of poetic devices and figurative language into his coy mistress. First is personification. The poet, or we can say the speaker, uses personification to describe time as though it has the human qualities of power, agency, and intelligence. For instance, in line 40, the speaker describes time as having slow-chipped power, suggesting that it has the capacity to break things. In line 22, time is described as having a winged chariot. In this poem, time owns things, moves around, drives horses. Even as the speaker describes time as an inexorable force, he also describes time as a character with intelligence and power. In this sense, the poem comes to seem like a drama, a fight between two kinds of intelligence, human and non-human. In this battle, the speaker seems almost ready to concede defeat as a character. Time seems in this poem omnipotent, incapable of being defeated. One might read this as part of the speaker's strategy. He wants to seduce his mistress by showing her that she has no better option. But the personification of time also makes its power seem overwhelming. So much so that one might imagine the speaker is making his case so strongly that the mistress' reaction might be one of panic and existential dread rather than erotic pleasure. The poem contains various literary devices that make the poetic persona's arguments more appealing and emotionally forceful. The poem implicitly compares coyness to crime. It is a metaphor. Here the poet thinks the coyness of the lady might kill the amorous spirit of his persona. In Long Love's Day, there is an alliteration as well as personification. Here the poet innovatively personifies love. The poetic persona uses several hyperboles while wooing his lady love. Such an exaggerated overtone is present in the following line, "Till the conversion of the Jews." The poet uses allusions in the following lines, "Love you 10 years before the flood and till the conversion of the Jews." The flood refers to Noah's flood. The second line contains a biblical allusion to the conversion of the Jews. In the poem, vegetable love is a metaphor, or specifically a metaphysical conceit. In the phrase, "Time's winged chariot," the poet first of all uses personification. It is also an allusion as well as a metaphor. In the last line of the poem, Marvel personifies the sun and says, "They will make him run." Now, the title. The title suggests that the author looked over the shoulder of a young man as he wrote a plea to the young lady. And the author then reported this plea exactly as the young man expressed it. However, the author added the title using the third person possessive pronoun his to refer to other young men. The word poet tells the reader that the lady is no easy catch. The word mistress can mean lady, manager, caretaker, courtesan, sweetheart, and lover. It can also serve as the female equivalent of master. In To His Coy Mistress, the word appears to be a synonym for lady or sweetheart. In reality, of course, Marvel wrote the entire poem. The persona, the young man. Although Andrew Marvel writes To His Coy Mistress in first person point of view, he presents the poem as the plea of another man. The poet enters the mind of the man and reports his thought as they manifest themselves. The young man is impatient, desperately so, unwilling to tolerate temporizing on the part of the young lady. His motivation appears to be carnal desire rather than true love. Passion rules him. Consequently, one may describe him as immature and selfish. Rhyme scheme. To His Coy Mistress is organized into rhyming couplets. Each couplet has its own rhyme. After Marvel completes one rhyme, he moves on to the next. One can see this pattern in the first 10 lines of the poem, which are rhymed AA, BB, CCC, DD, AE. Thank you.